Good morning, brothers and sisters. Blessings be unto you. We're glad to have you with us on this morning. We're going to go to the Word of God, but just always counting it a privilege to be here. You'll see my eyes kind of go up and down here because the camera's here and the my program is kind of down here, so you'll see me move up and down. Hope that's not too disturbing. We're going to get into the Word of God on this morning, but I just want to greet you in the divine love of God and so grateful for those who, whether you're watching us live right now or watching this back at any point once it's posted onto the channel and onto my personal pages, we're just so glad that you count us worthy to be a viewer, to be somebody who can speak with you and to you as a uplift and an encouragement. That being said, let's get right to the Word. You know me, I don't want to keep you long. It's bright and early, and if you're all the way over the West Coast, as many on the channel are, channel subscribers, if you will, are, it's 5 a.m. Yes, it's 5:01 a.m. there. So if you're up and about now, God bless you. Some are getting ready for work. Some are be up for morning devotional, we're grateful to be a part of that. And so it's best do what you want us to do, what you're here for us to do. Excuse me. It says in Philippians chapter 1, we're going to start at verse 3. Here's what it says. I give thanks to my God for every remembrance of you, always praying with joy for all of you in my ever prayer, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. I am sure of this, that he who has started a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you because I have you in my heart, and you are all partners with me in grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and establishment of the gospel. For God is my witness how I deeply miss all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And I pray this, that love will keep on growing in knowledge and every kind of discernment, so that you can determine what really matters and can be pure and blameless the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. What wonderful, wonderful text there. And we're going to get into it here and get out of your way. And so my point this morning is the work has begun, with an emphasis on verse 6. But before we go there, let's consider a few things as maybe a background and an establishment of this word. We want to set it in a firm foundation. The first thing we want to recognize is the author here is the Apostle Paul, approximately around 61 AD. And of course, these are approximations. Some may be a bit more firm in their assertion of it takes place, others not so much. So approximately around 60 AD, this has come after his second missionary journey, and he's in prison. He is in Rome, and he's locked in prison. And Paul is afforded the opportunity in some places to be able to write while in those kind of conditions. He's writing, of course, to Philippi. Well, Philippi is where he went. As a matter of fact, if you go over to Acts chapter 60, you don't have to turn there. What you will see is when he's passing through on his second missionary journey, passing through Europe, Philippi is one of the cities that he stops in. And what's so amazing is Paul had, if you do your research, do your study, Paul had a tendency, and I'm sure quite intentional, to go to major cities, Ephesus, Philippi, Corinth. These are places where you have a mosh posh, excuse the term, but you have a melting pot, that's what they say here in America, of Greeks and Roman citizens, Italians, you have Gentiles, Corinth, for example, is a city where it has a lot of merchants coming through due to a passageway there. So Paul is able to, even though these are heathen places, they have heathen gods and goddesses, temples all over the place in Europe this time in the first century. He's going to these places. They also, of course, have Jewish settlements as they have been dispersed out of Jerusalem and settled in these cities. So he runs pockets of Jews, as we know, because some of them try to beat him up, and in some cases do beat him up, stone him, and try to kill him. So he's traveling to these cities, and he's finding these collections of Jews, Greeks, or Gentile nations that are there as merchants, again, transients, maybe prophets, whatever the case may be, as well as Roman citizens. Why is that important? Because Paul has dual citizenship. He is a Roman citizen as well as he is a straight up bona fide Jew. So it's just something to consider for those of you who are avid studiers of scripture. Paul is, I believe, was quite strategic in the places that he selected. Philippi is one of those places that he goes to. Now, that keeping that in mind, he goes there, and this is not only a prominent city for the Roman Empire, they settled a colony there, but it's also a prominent place for selling. For example, there's a lady named Lydia who gets saved, who comes to faith in Jesus Christ, who is a purple, and these people are able to house him. So it's not just a place where there's people who are from all over the place, but there are some prominent people there. If you have a Roman colony there, Rome settled colonies of their citizens in these cities, and that also means, watch this, they put garrisons there. They put centurion. There's probably a centurion there in this city, which means a chief in the Roman army, okay, a chieftain in the Roman army. So this is some huge stuff going on here, and Paul has run into, unfortunately, a problem there. And this is where we get the, and if you look at Acts chapter 16, drop down around verse 12 and read on, he's going to be locked in a Roman jail. So I want to make sure you understand, this city is a place where he suffered imprisonment, where they tried to not only kill him, but ultimately, typically, to kill him. And so here he's writing to them, and we'll get to it in a moment, why he's writing to them. But I want you to understand the backdrop. I want you to understand the background. He's gone to this city. He's gone on a Sabbath day to a place of prayer. Lydia gets saved. She invites him and his traveling companions, this Paul, to her home. He stays there, he's preaching. Eventually he finds himself locked in a jail, him and Silas, and we know the story, cries out, praises God, admit not a cry is made, as it states in the scripture. And God shakes that place until they are loosed from their bonds. However, Paul understands, stay with me, Paul understanding what his responsibility is, he does not, and Silas does not leave the prison, watch this, stays there, even though the foundations of that place is shaken. And keep in mind, prison ain't like what we have today in America. We're talking about a dungeon-like conditions where they're in the muck and the mire and in chains and fetters, and it's late at night. They're probably not being treated very well. They don't have civil rights in any kind of form, and God shakes them, frees them, but they don't leave because the jailer is about to kill himself. I'm sure you remember. And Paul calls out and says, don't kill yourself. Prisoners have not escaped, him being one of them. They're all present. We are still here. And in fact, his whole family comes to faith in God. I could preach that, but let's move on. So that in mind, by the time you get to the text, the church that was born during this experience Paul had in Philippi, so I'll be able to give you that, is now come to a point, it's fairly well established. Now, one of the ways that you can figure this out is, you can read the verses, but verses 1 and 2, Paul writes to the church, including acknowledging the leadership. So here you have Paul, who passes through on his second mission years prior, and God moves by his power. Lydia's household, the jailer's household, again, comes to faith in God. And by the time he's writing to them, now you have a whole structure. The church is structured with elders and deacons there. So that's powerful. That means the gospel has grown so to the fact that the people, the gospel has grown in the hearts of the people. People are coming to salvation so to the fact that you have to have leadership established to be able to govern the people of God and to run the body of Christ, or to oversee the body of Christ. As a matter of fact, in some translations refer to as overseers, elders, or bishops, that all the Greek term there. And so that's extremely huge to understand that God's intention, first to Jerusalem, right? Acts chapter 1, verse 8, usually by witnesses, first in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and all the most parts of the earth. It's working, the gospel is spreading. People are coming to faith in God, whether Jew or Gentile, God be praised. And so you can see that then our next point, is the fact that Paul is writing the letter. If you say, well, why is he writing the letter? Ultimately, it is, of course, to encourage. It is, if there's any issues, to address those issues. But there seems to be no prevailing issue with this particular church at this particular time, according to what we read, a small letter. Not quite as small as Colossians, of course, but fairly small and highly encouraging. The Philippian church, as a matter of fact, notice he calls them partners. And he says, you have been partners with me, verses we read, so we can get the context. You have been partners with me from day one. Lydia invited him into the house. You see where I'm going with this? Lydia invited him into the house. The jailer, despite the fact that he could have been put to death, actually, allows or aids Paul and Silas in getting free so that they can, and escaping from Philippi, so that they can continue to preach the gospel. I mean, this, they're partnering with Paul and with Silas and his traveling companions in the spreading of the gospel. And he says, from day one, even until now, keeping in mind how they had to travel in that time, there is no social media, there is no emails, there is no electronic devices of any kind. This is people walking, riding donkeys, carrying letters back and forth, getting on ships, traveling by ships, and nothing with powered boats and nothing like that. And he's finding out now, sometime later, that they have continued in God. The church has grown. Stay with me. The church has grown. And so he's saying, look, you guys have been not only partnering with me, watch this, in terms of spreading the gospel, calling them brothers and sisters, but he's saying also in your generosity. Also in your generosity. You can see that over in chapter 4, 10 through 18. So it's generally believed that the largest thrust of why Paul is writing this, rushing on here, is to say thank you and to encourage them, despite what he's going through, despite what he's suffering, despite that even though he left Philippi, now he's locked in another situation. He's in prison for preaching the gospel, and they are hearing of this. But then look, you've been generous, you've been helpful, you've been blessing, you've been continuing in the things that God had me preach to you. You're contending. As a matter of fact, if you read it carefully, as we reread what we read, he says you've been not only partnering with me with generosity, but you've also been defending the gospel. Keep in mind, Paul was thrown in prison for his preaching of the gospel, and they have continued, despite what Paul went through, what they helped save him from, they have continued to do this. So Paul says, you are partners with me from the first day to the last, the last being up to this point. And he says, look, I'm writing you, and it's good for me to write you this and to tell you this, because you have been a blessing to me. You have been an encouragement to me, not only in your financial gifts, but also in how the fact that you are continuing in the gospel and the gospel message is spreading. The gospel message is spreading. As a matter of fact, he writes, I am sure of this, that he that has started, and here we are, a good work in you will carry it on to completion. So this is where I want to come and encourage really all of you. And if you're not active, your faith is not active in God, brothers and sisters, I pray you hear this message this morning or whenever you're watching this back, that you would get busy for the Lord. Keep in mind, imprisonment. There's very few, at least in the United States of America, and to all my brothers and sisters in the other countries that are on this channel, blessings be to you. And if you're in one of those countries where you are fighting an uphill battle, we're praying for you, brothers and sisters. We want to encourage you to continue the fight, the battle. We're with you. My spirit is with you, brothers, my spirit, sisters, my spirit is with you. But even for those in this country where we are not facing, as it is, such ominous circumstances, we are not under the gun, if you will. We can speak openly as I sit here in my home this morning, talking very openly, not screaming, but I'm talking loud enough to be heard, I suspect, at least outside my door. And I have no fear that somebody's going to bust in here, take me to prison, kill me, and I stop talking about Jesus Christ. And in their circumstance, Paul is saying, look, you're my partner. You have been not only generous, but you are continuing to spread the gospel. That's why I'm calling you partners, because despite the circumstances that you are facing, and even I, keep reading chapter 1, that I am facing, as a matter of fact, he says in chapter 1, around verse 20, 21, somewhere in there, I even got people who are preaching. I've been made aware that there are people who are preaching out of rivalry, right? But yet, hey, if they're preaching Christ, then so be it. I want you to understand, brothers and sisters, whatever you're facing, whatever you're going through, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, God has already started the work. The work has been begun in you. And Paul says, being confident of this, no matter what you're going through or will go through or have gone through, it is not likely difficult, the circumstances that they're seeing in Philippi. Paul is experiencing at the time that he's writing this, but I tell you this, that it's not to diminish it at all. Whatever you're suffering with, what you're going through, Jesus is the one who started that work. Jesus is the one who started, and I promise you, and I want to encourage you, that you're going to have to believe some. I know all the prophecies, and I'll be generous this morning, all the prophecies that you're hearing is 2020 is your year, is going to be this, is going to be that, a year of blessings, your vision. Hey, I'm not here to dissuade you from whatever you're hoping God to do, but understand this, when it's all said and done, life is going to be exactly what it is, good, bad, or different. As a matter of fact, I got so many messages yesterday about people are going to funerals. I was like, good gracious, we're barely 3 weeks in, three Sundays now in. As you can see, as I can see, at least a funeral, one here, and these people don't know each other, and all these funerals, there's friends I have all over the place who are attending funerals, which means somebody passed within this year. They didn't hold that over for, okay, just wait till the other side of the year, and then 3 weeks in. No, somebody died within the last 5 to 7 days, give it or take, and they had to have a funeral. That person didn't get the 2020 vision, clear vision. As a matter of fact, actually, if they were believers, they are now in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, and their vision is absolutely clear, spiritually, in every way you can imagine. But understand this. In other words, people are going to die. People are going to get sick. All kind of people have been sick at the opening of this year, son included. In other words, it's just going to be what it always is. Some are going to go up. Some are going to go down. Some are going to see financial doors open. Jobs they've always wanted finally come open. Some are going to lose jobs. The economy is what it is. It didn't stop being that because we changed years. I'm speaking to those of you who are believers in God. That's what this program is about, to tell you, brothers and sisters, no matter how difficult or the great triumph that you experience, keep your faith in God. Understanding this, the reason why you have that faith in the first place is because it was God who, through Jesus Christ, called it to be so. Hebrews, as a matter of fact, chapter 12 says it, therefore, since we also have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance of the sin that so easily ensnares us. let us run with endurance. You hear what I'm saying? With endurance, the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, keeping our eyes on Jesus, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the source and perfecter. One translation says the author and the finisher of our faith. For joy that was laid before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right of the throne of God. Brothers and sisters, I can't get it any clearer than that. The work has been begun. He is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. There is nothing that's going to go on in 2020, 2021, 2022, and on and on and on until you take your last breath, until I take my breath. I am assured by God himself from the word of God that no matter what goes on, we are people of faith. We trust in, and that faith was a gift given to us. Romans 12, verse 3, that's a gift that we were given so that we could respond like Lydia and like the jailer in Acts chapter 16. We could respond to the gospel, and we can be like those in Philippi. We can be generous. As a matter of fact, Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, and I'm almost done. My time's almost up. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 6 through 10 about being bountiful givers, cheerful givers instead of sparing giving. And bountiful don't mean you got to give 1,000 every week. Bountiful means you're giving with a glad heart and you're giving as the Spirit is leading you, and you are not trying to be pinching the pennies. No, God can, you can give 10 cents on the dollar, give 10 cents. If you can give 50 cents on the dollar, give 50 cents. Give 80 cents. On every dollar, give 80 cents. Understand this, with a smile, it's with cheerful. And then Paul will say to you, I'm saying, as Paul said, you're partners, you are partners. God sees you as, as a matter of fact, one pastor says, I don't have the coordinates with me, talks about the fact that we're co-laborers with God. I believe that's over in Corinthians. Get that, co-laborers with God. Jesus says in the gospel according to John, I believe chapter 14, toward the end, he says that you are witnesses with the Holy Spirit. Do you understand the magnitude of that? Brothers and sisters, somebody's watching this and you're feeling like you're just not doing enough. No, 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 no. Hear me. God began, and the fact that you have such a desire to bless the ministry, to you may not be a preacher, a teacher, that's fine. God has called those whom he's called, but saved you by somebody preaching and teaching the scriptures, some plant, some water. He brought the increase. And I want you to understand, and let me say this as a person full-time ministry. Thank you. I join Paul in saying, I appreciate your generosity. You may not be a dime, that's fine. But if you've helped any ministry, you have given your offerings to any ministry and they are getting the work done. I thank you on behalf of those ministries, because like Paul said to the church in Philippi, you are enabling the work, and especially I'll say whether you can give a dime or not, if you are defending the gospel, if you are, that word there, Peter uses apologia, if you are prepared to give an answer for a defense for the faith that lies within you, your faith in Jesus, brothers and sisters, I am with you. I am here for you. Not just to come on here and preach for a few minutes. You need help with anything. I want to support you. Paul and Peter and James and John and Bartholomew and on supported the believers in that day. I want to encourage you to keep going, to keep holding on, to keep believing. As a matter of fact, here's what Paul says, and we end with these words. He said, Philippians chapter 2, just go over one chapter, 12 and 13. Therefore, dear friends, just as you have always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but even more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But 13 is where I really want to give, for it is God who is working in you both to will and to work according to his good purpose. Be blessed, my brothers and sisters, knowing that he that has begun a good work in you is performing it and is going to perform it all the way until the time when Christ comes and does home. Be blessed.